that could happen.
We're praying, Jeremy.
Welcome, Bob Greenyer. It's a pleasure, sir.
Thank you for the invite. It must be a crazy time for you. It's normally a crazy time for me.
Yeah, I'm a bit of a nocturnal beast by nature, and it's about 4 a.m. here in Calgary, Alberta right now.
Yeah, that's kind of when I normally go to bed.
Nice.
Right? There's never enough time in a day, so it always goes into night.
Oh, it's me. My mind gets clouded by other people's thoughts.
So, as you can see here, I've got some identical windings to what you're currently working on. And this inner one right here is actually ferrite outer wrapping and then copper inner core wrapping, inverted of what you're currently proposing in my next project to build and do.
Very nice.
I love the way the universe works, because I made it like at least 5, if not 6 years ago now. And
is there any way you can get a closer shot of? Is there any way you can get a closer shot of it? Okay, so that is I can't see, but it looks like a 3-level tour, right?
Yep, 3-level tour.
Yeah, so in theory, that according to the 1980s work of the Russians, that should be capable of producing a closed pointing vector. Maybe not in that twisted configuration. You've got it in a figure of eight loop there.
Yeah, exactly. Like, and that's another thing is I know that the connection wiring the way I have it isn't optimal or correct, most likely, and that I just kind of had it like that in the meantime, but they're easy to take apart and use, and they work as individual coils.
Not entirely sure why my camera's not working. Is that something to do with StreamYard, or I'm on a Mac? Is there something I need to configure to allow it to work? I don't know.
Yeah, it might have to just go into settings and alter, and it should allow it. It's strange.
Okay.
It's just easy.
Oh, right. Yeah. I see what's going on. It's trying to use an NDI video. There we go.
There we go. Welcome.
How you doing? So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to probably build a whole bunch of different cores with the various left, right, or right, left, or left, right, or right, left, configurations. And then I'm going to propose, I'm going to model up, for instance, what Henk Uren has done by using a rope in the middle of the 2-level tours to make the 3-level tours, facilitating the production of the 4-level tours. And then I'm going to swap it out and do a bit that Cosmic Dave is doing, where he's using the type of hosing that you would use in plumbing a fish tank or garden things, these kind of like polypropylene or polyethylene tubes. And I think those, if you can get one that like you've got there, so he's got rope in his second level tour to make the 3-level tour, and that facilitates winding that. And of course, it's equivalent to an air. So you can see the rope there in that video. And then he's putting that around a piece of sort of plumbing. I'm proposing maybe to use something like that plumbing with a thermosetting plastic and then inject into there some ferrofluid in both of the level coil tours, so that you could actually make a ferrous core on the tour 1, tour 2, and tour 3. And whether that will have an effect, I don't know, but these are
words. I get what you're saying, and it's essentially a triple induction on the magnetic aspect, but it's like a mini tokamak, really, that you're going to have running.
Well, I don't know. This is for people to explore, but the purpose of putting it out yesterday, which I want, if I'd have had access to this tool sooner, I would have put out those models. So I knew I could build it with a model because I was experienced with the tool back in the early 2000s. And I just wanted to get it out so that people are on the same page, so that when people are saying left, right, right, or left, left, right, right, that everyone was calling them the same thing, so that any results that came out, whether there was E fields or persistent E fields or persistent magnetic fields or other weird effects, then it would be useful for comparison between different researchers' work. So are you making some ormus there bubbling away, or is it?
Yeah, so when the first hour that I had it going, it was pure white. It always comes off the anode side, so I suspect it's monoatomic when it's the pure white. It started to go a bit gray now. The anode is a combination. I've got a sheet of aluminum, a sheet of zinc, as well as pure copper solenoid wrap around it, and then an iron ferrite giant nail center core of it. So it's those four elements that are producing the precipitate plasmoid monodiatomic material that's forming in this. And then all of the hydrogen and Brown's gas bubbling off of the cathode side.
Lovely. Well, don't blow yourself up. I'm sure you're not going to do that.
Exactly. I usually only do it on the outside, just have it running briefly for the stream inside with well-ventilated giant windows.
Great. Good. Yeah, so there's the video you just showed of Henk Urin there. I haven't said this publicly, but I'll say it now. The implication is that the metal sheet above there, because he did a test by moving that coil to another location where there wasn't a metal roof above, and the field became spherical. Obviously, metal sheets in sort of Swiss roll type fashion were orgone accumulators, and of course, the orgone is almost certainly relic neutrino flux, in my view. And so, it could be that what you're seeing is exotic vacuum objects or things that are related to that feed off electrons, and obviously they have this relationship with the relic neutrino flux. We already know from the work of Alexander Parkhomov, these things can be partially reflected by metal. And so there's definitely an interaction there. What we're seeing with that field shape bending, it implies to me that just like you can focus relic neutrino flux, then you could probably focus the fields from these coils. And if it does have a disruptive field, that becomes really rather scary, actually. So I think anyone listening here, you need to be very, very careful with these things. Gverblis got involved with this because he was interested in two-level tors interacting with human biology. He couldn't quite believe the effect that he was witnessing when he saw this research in 1988. And well, to cut a long story short, there wasn't just him working on this. There was a lot of people. Most of them are dead, not necessarily from this, but just because they got too old to continue to exist. However, it's pretty clear to me that these will have strong biological effects, which is why I'm encouraging people to not push this to the max, and to do observational studies, which will take time with seed growth, particularly because that is a good indicator. But it needs people that are very skilled in hydroponics, and you don't want to feed water that you're feeding the control sample through the test sample. You need to have them drip fed at the same rate from, you know, those kind of things. You need to have them drip fed from a single source of water, and have them in the same sort of temperature and humidity environment. And by then looking at different tor levels, whether it's a 3-tor or a 4-tor, and having the different number of coils and the different configuration, left, right, left, we can get to some understanding of what has a field that suppresses growth and cell division and so on. And I'll refer people to the work of Simon Schnoll, where he looked at all of these random, so-called random processes in nature from papers, over 1,000 papers from 1950s to 2012. And he found that there must be a common cosmophysical factor that relates to absolutely all of these things. And I believe that these cores are able to tap into manipulation of that cosmophysical factor. And so when we find one of these things will promote growth or suppress growth, it, in my view, will naturally enable suppression of cancer tumor growth. It will enable promotion of white blood cells, which will help do the opposite to, you know, promoting cancer. It will help prevent and help with fast healing and disease management. It will help with seed germination. As I said in my talk on the weekend, if you can give seeds a very, very good start so that they are strong right just shortly after germination, this has implications to agriculture and to, how should we put this, the smoke market. There's all kinds of different applications that have intense value.
That you're so speaking my language, it's amazing. And how aware of you are of the Keshi Foundation and, for instance, like their triple Magrav coils and what Keshi calls GANS, which is just another acronym for Ormus.
Ormus, if you think about it, is effectively it's a multi-level tour, but at the atomic level. And so I think what you'll find is that these are effectively able to harness some energy from the physical vacuum or cohere the cold neutrino condensate. And so that is, I believe, what Ormus is doing. It would even do that if you ingest it. And the reason why this ties up is, as I said in my stream on the weekend, and I briefly mentioned this, that David Hudson said, look, you know, we did test this for people. But, you know, for those that already have cancer, it will accelerate the cancer. But for those that don't already have cancer, it will prevent them from developing cancer, if you know what I mean. And so it has the same biological effect that the observations of Shishkin did when they were having a stream of Rayleigh neutrino condensates, which are string vortex solitons. I mean, I can see what you're showing there. I have looked at an Ormus that was generated from gold in Hungary. I will share that data at some point, but we could not find a resolution on the SEM that was able to show less subdivisions. It was incredibly, incredibly small. So, yeah, I mean, my view on Ormus is you really need to know the state of your biology before consuming it.
Because I believe that's 100% correct. The one person that I did make some monoatomic gold, zinc, copper, silver combination for their father who was succumbing to leukemia, I believe it did actually accelerate the condition of it, which was sad. And that's why I haven't done it anymore. Because
life wants the energy that these things are able to...
It magnifies whatever field is within the area. So if you have the field of the disease there and you don't have it pinged in to target that and you're just putting a multiplier in with putting these materials in, it's going to multiply whatever there's the most of.
And I think it's simple. Disease,
it's going to make it worse.
I think it's simple.
If you're healthy, it's good.
If you think the cancer cell wants to divide and it's got no breaks on its level of division. Normal cells, the body is telling them to divide. They'll divide until they fulfill their role. Fantastic! It's great to see more coils. They'll divide until they have fulfilled what they've been asked to do, and then they will stop. Cancer cells don't do that. They continue to divide, and all biology will use what it can to divide as fast as it can to get the job done. And when you give ormus or you treat it with these relic neutrino condensate flux in the form of string vortex photons or black evos, they are the one and the same thing effectively, and they will accelerate the division process. And so, you know, we've got things that David Hudson said in the 1980s, and now we have a deep understanding of the underlying mechanism for these things. So I kind of prefer the idea that if we can create the condensates and treat people in the right part of their body, we can generally improve health. But when I worked to try and help some people that had cancer that were after using Francesco Piantelli's service in Italy, and I went through the whole process with Francesco Piantelli. He absolutely will not permit anyone that has not gone through the normal medical procedures to access his technology. So they have to go through chemotherapy if that fails, and then they go through, you know, maybe incising and removing cancers. And if that fails and there's no hope, he will then go ahead and treat. But I never had from, in fact, interestingly, he uses 50 hertz. And he actually has patents out there how 50 hertz is quite good at resonating with biological media. And that's interesting because in the States you run at 60 hertz, which is against this frequency. He actually has papers and patents, I think, out there, certainly papers.
I'm so happy you're bringing this topic up specifically, because it's something I'm trying to dive deeper into, my science of sound and the different frequencies of electromagnetic waves going into both music as well as electricity, the currents, and the different wavelengths that they have them operating on, and changed them and manipulated them over the years from what was more natural to what they are now.
Yeah, I mean, my brother in Israel, he has an entire record label where they remaster dance tracks to 432 hertz from whatever it is.
Okay, yeah, so, well, we have to book your brother for a future episode, please.
He's absolute legend.
I mean, what I am looking for in our series.
He basically produces a lot of trance and acid and all kinds of really fast beat music and trippy.
We've
got
to trade and swap tracks sometimes, Bob. And by the way, awesome to see you on here. Cannot believe you're awake. I wanted to mention a couple things.
Well, no,
about
this is easy for me because this is my day.
Right, I figured. I was like, out of all the ones I said, Bob, it might be morning time before he's off to work and has his busy day, and we'll see if we can get him on. And it worked out, and blessed to everyone being here and watching.
I'm just so amazed you got Bob on, man. If you could have got anyone else on here tonight, I mean, talk about epic. So we started the show by looking at the beautiful rendering of the super tour, as you called it, which is actually a fourth order tour. And a gorgeous one at that. And taking a look at this stuff. Okay, so we're just looking at these little spirals, and I'll give an instruction for anyone that wants to replicate one of these very terribly difficult to replicate things. Okay, this is one of those fiberglass rods from Home Depot. Mm-hmm. And these are used for snowplow trucks to identify where not to drive into. And anyways, you can stick this whole entire 4 or 5 foot length into a drill, and start by spiraling your wire around this rod. And because this rod is fiberglass, and because copper is springy, which can be a bit of a problem, what I did is hook up both sides of each full length to a power supply and heated the wire up, not to the point of destroying the insulation, but we're only talking about, you know, maybe running 20 or 30 volts here at 30 hertz, according to the original paper, which is not going to be a problem, even if the insulation was slightly damaged, but it's not. I got it to the point where it darkened, and what that did was anneal the copper just enough so that it didn't try to unspring or unwind itself when I pulled the whole thing off the rod. And because it still had just a bit of spring to it, it was very easy to remove. So I just took those in sections, and I'll show if I can. So here's a section.
Can I step in there? Because that's a very valuable thing, what I think you've done there. But I think maybe, could there be a way where you could get one of these thermal tapes and put it around the point at which you're winding? And so you're just only applying the heat for the time it needs to do the winding, or just prior to it?
No, you couldn't, because you need to anneal the entirety of the copper loop. And if you try to heat this from the outside,
progressively winding.
Oh, I guess, yeah, you could.
So you're not continuously heating the whole wire. You're just doing it, you preheat it just before you go into winding, or just post-heating it, like you do when you're perming someone's hair, right?
Yeah, that's actually a really good idea. If you wound it and did not have to, you know, if you didn't have to rewind it at all or make any mistakes, and you didn't have to tighten it because it was a perfectly tight wind, or make any adjustments after putting your length on the rod, and you had already annealed it, then of course it would want to hold its shape because it's not going to want to unbend. But the trouble is that when you buy magnet wire, it's already gone through a multiple number of spoolers and rollers. And so it's going to have a bit of a memory to it. And we need to remove that first. Of course, we need to remove that without damaging the insulation. And I figure the best way to do that is actually from the inside out. So anyways, when you go to wind these things, after you get it on the rod, you take it, you know, you take the long single coil off the rod, you wind these loops back around the rod. And what I ended up doing was just kind of running a whole long length of hot glue right down the side. Now, this is a terrible method. I would not recommend that people try this, because the hot glue, if it seeps in a little too deeply, or if you're off by, you know, say you want to attach just four coils together, five coils together, five loops of each of these coils together, if it's a little too thick, it's not going to bend, and that's a major problem. So don't do that. What I would instead actually recommend doing is taking a long strip of, say, flexible tape of some kind and running a bead of silicone along it, and then setting this down into it and waiting for that silicone to cure. If you don't want to wait 24 hours for silicone to cure, then get yourself a two-part silicone epoxy mix. It's not technically epoxy, but, you know, two-part silicone. And that way you can get each of these rod lengths done in, say, 2 hours or less. And so I just wanted to point out the connection point here at the middle. Let me roll back around there, because for people wanting to replicate, this is kind of important, because you can only wind, say, 5 feet at a time. So there it is. There's just this little solder point where right in the middle of the loop, we make that splice. Uh-huh. And for a full tour, we would actually need to make probably 3 or 4 splices all together, ending up with a total loop length like this of almost, well, for this size rod, I think this is like a 6 millimeter. So we'd probably end up with a whole loop length, if we just looked at something like this, of about maybe 10 foot long. And that, of course, adds its own complexities. But I wanted to ask you something specific, and I've been wanting to ask it since the day that you did the original broadcast, the one that you were so excited about before translation, epic broadcast. And that part is the one that I think stands out the most. Not whether or not the field projection is strange or anything else like that, but the fact that you disconnect the signal generator, according to the author of that paper, and that a magnetic field probe, or a microtesla-meter, as they call it in that paper, picks up, feeding to an oscilloscope, a continuous signal for up to 2 days at the same frequency with the identical wavelength, slowly decaying in amplitude over 2 days. Here's what I wanted to ask you, but I have to premise, you know, what we were talking about first. And we have to remember that the oscilloscope and the probe have an input impedance. That means there's a resistor in there of some kind, or some kind of resistance down the line. So in order for that probe head to do work, in order for that probe head to pick up a signal, it has to be doing work, which means the oscillating field stuck in space is actually generating a usable magnetic field.
Yeah.
As long as we don't swipe it out or knock it out with a spark discharge, we could be looking at a system that's upscalable that generates a massively powerful and useful magnetic field, which continues to operate after only a small amount of input power and priming for up to 2 days. Okay. So, I mean, that's what I wanted to ask you about, your thoughts on what could we do with that. And do you think that if we really tried to load that, or if we put an external field pickup coil around it, that we might destroy the cluster, or that we might destabilize the natural geometry that the evil is formed, or I should say the virtual evil, if that's even what it is?
So, firstly, I would say that what you're forcing nature to do is what it wants to do anyway. And so it's kind of like corralling a load of sheep into a pen, or schooling fish, you know, like dolphins do. You can think of the coil, in my view, this is the way I visualize it. I'm thinking of the coil as like the team of dolphins, and they are getting the sardines to ball up. Okay. So that's kind of how I visualize it. And so what I'm trying to encourage is people to use natural things like plants who want to do this anyway, to cohere this condensate from the cosmos, and you are encouraging that process to go on that already wants to happen in nature. And so David Boutillier is working on a system where he's making these coils. He's keeping it at the three-level tor, like it would look like you're doing with three-level tor. And that's the one that showed the effect. And that should show a magnetic persistent field, as claimed by Schwerblis' observation of the teams for the three-level tor.
That's the most exciting part about the whole thing. If we can scoop that, and I love what Hank's doing, and I love what Cosmic Dave is doing. But
I'm talking about David Boutillier. David Boutillier is looking to one of the suggestions is, or the first suggestion actually was to try and make your ball lightning. So he's creating a plasma reactor and having the coil in there, and he will put in the coil in clay and have cooling going through it. So that it doesn't get damaged, but that might encourage self-clustering of the plasma. So this for me is a very, very exciting prospect, because when we already know ball lightning can consume matter, and in the process of consuming it, it's actually doing this self-organization anyway. But if we have a precise way where we can force the ball lightning to be produced out on demand in a particular location, then ball lightning can spin at hundreds of thousands of the matter around the ball lightning, like the charged particles, they can spin at hundreds of thousands of kilometers per second. And so you can then have a pickup coil, which may actually be the coil that you use to form it. It may play two roles and then get induction back. In the case of Solin in his 2001 patent, he created the coherent matter, which span, and then he had a single cooled induction coil to harness the direct electricity that would be generated from that effect. So, but of course, Solin used an electron beam furnace, which was just, it's a very large device. It's a commercial device for melting metals that are very high temperature. And he used that to create the cone that produced the spinning coherent matter, and then had the pickup coil. And so what we're moving from this is that very high energy, large device, and trying to get something that's very, very small that would generate the same thing. So the direct electricity and energy generation is for me, one of the biggest things that we can move towards. But I think it's absolutely critical that everyone gets involved with understanding which left, right, and which level of tors will have the greatest biological effect. Because once we know what it does to biology...
That's actually a key point, Bob, just to interject quickly. And that the Keshi Foundation teachings as well state the exact same, where they do triple anti-clockwise, so the left way at three anti-clockwise coil solenoids within themselves. And it seems that it is something, because it's the same exact parallel, same conclusion that you've come to. And
what I'm saying is, this is new eternal fire. This is eternal. You only have to sit and meditate for long enough and you will come up with this. You only have to observe nature for long enough and you will realize this. What I did in looking at John Hutchison's work to come up with the structure is what any sentient being who was paying enough attention could do at any point in the universe. So this is not something that can be owned. It is the fundamental root level of nature, and it is our birthright. And we have definitely, because of the archaeological record and all of the symbols of power, we have used this technology as a species long before the modern era. And so we know we can use it, right? We know we can use it because we were using it and talking about it in all of our art in the past. And so it's the most important things that get passed forward for generation after generation. All of the symbols of power, the fleur-de-lis, the yin-yang, the swastika, the Maltese cross, the paisley, all of these symbols of power are which everyone puts on their, you know, their bags and their clothing when they go to meditate and stuff. This is not an accident. This is humans trying to pass the knowledge forward to other humans, regardless of cataclysm. Regardless of cataclysm. And so...
For the betterment of human.
For yes. the freedom of humanity.
Well, for the betterment of everything, actually. Because when you understand how nature works, you can understand that you can completely destroy nature with this technology.
And that's what we're doing right now, this explosive destructive, where we can need to transition to the way the ancients had it and mastered it, where it's implosive, endothermic, but it's in harmony with nature, and thus it is symbiotic with nature, where the what better humanity did, the better nature did, as opposed to now where we're destroying it all. And that
to be fair, both making and destroying is useful. So, for instance, by using this technology and variations of it, you can take radioactive material that naturally occurs and make it, destroy it, and make it into matter you can consume. And that is creative destruction.
Yeah, once we understand exactly... let me just mention one thing. Once we understand completely how we can control the transmutation of exactly what matter we're starting with and exactly what matter we want to end with, instead of just ending up with random pits and pieces of foil or Hutchinson samples that could really go either way because the resonant nodes are such differential energy levels and may transmute the elements into a number of different things, if we could control that down to the very pinpoint accuracy and we want to produce as much palladium as we need, and down to something very dangerous, like you're talking about earlier.
Of course, 99 out of 100 people that hear of my work want to know how to make gold and other precious metals within the first 10 minutes of their thinking about the implications. We definitely did this in the past.
I'm so glad you guys are talking about this, because I truly feel that I have the theory of how to make it happen through Sir Isaac Newton's alchemy, what I've been producing on my own, and then John Hutchinson's work in getting the resonant frequencies of these metals and the harmonics of it, and then putting it into these electrolysis reactions on the anode and cathode side, and then be able to have that atomic hydrogen being formed bond with the crystalline transmutational state that the metal is, the base metal, and then have it successfully and always precisely turn into that higher metal atomic mass is adding to from the hydrogen going into that crystalline resonance of the metal, resonant frequency of the metal you're aiming to have.
Well, absolutely, it's going to be resonance. But if you want to make something resonate or form into a target material, you have to have a template, and the template needs to give out exactly the full spectrum complex resonance. It isn't about one frequency. It's about a folded cluster of frequencies. So, and this is where the philosopher's stone for synthesizing a particular element is and can only be a monoatomic. The reason being is that as soon as you get two nuclei in a diatomic cluster, they will not vibrate at the nucleus complex clustered set of resonances that the individual atom will by itself. Now, it actually doesn't necessarily matter so much about the orbital electrons as the actual wave function of the cluster that is the nucleus, right? So what you need to do is be able to get that little thing to sing and then put it in. And this is why the Philosopher's Stone is basically a template. And I spoke about this in my 2016 presentation in Azizi. You can go and see it. And I say that basically at the beginning of the universe, if you believe that story, but anyway, we can have many universes beginning, but the light hasn't reached us yet from the other universes that are in another dark part of space, because light takes time to travel and we're never going to see it, so we won't know. And then when they do merge, it'll just be another existence. But the point being is that you have this prima materia, which is just raw energy, and it doesn't know what to be. And at some point, there is self-organization that forms a monoatom. There will always be one atom that gets formed first of each of the types of atoms that are possible, given what nature can build, okay? And then let's say you have God over here. I've described this in that 2016 lecture as, you know, the different elements are like God, Buddha, Jesus, Buddha, and Muhammad, and they're all very charismatic, and they have their own idea of how things can should be. And the primitive material doesn't know what it's doing because they're just the sheeple. And they said, well, I kind of like what you're saying, so I'm going to go and join your football team. And I like what you're saying, so I'm going to go join your hockey team, and so on. And you then have a certain amount. And the more easy it is to form the original nuclei, the more likely you will have some of that nuclei being in abundance. So the most simple... The most simple element you can synthesize is the nucleus of protium, hydrogen, one proton, right? So it's natural that out of the prima materia, most of the material will have initially formed protium. And then you have this nature, which is ontologically not happy with just protium. It builds these other structures that can progressively build other elements. And those are called suns and black holes and supernova and so on. So the clear thing to me is that nature always has an ontological will to create life. And life itself is part of creating these variety of elements. And so it likes variety. It doesn't like... individual monoculture. It doesn't like monoculture. It likes variance. And you can see this when we do any of our experiments. Whatever you put in, you get a spread spectrum of elements being synthesized. Right. Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously the guy's a freaking genius.
But specifically of how nature operates, and it goes into fractals always, right? It doesn't like that... forced single structure, and right?
There's one ring to rule them all.
Well, if I may, just to kind of clearly understand you and verify, what we're talking about here is being able to generate field geometries that can physically modify the vacuum, if you will, the aether,
yes,
to create protomatter right out of the energy that's already latent in space-time, which means that we don't have to necessarily transmute something, but we could actually fabricate it straight out of the vacuum if we want to.
From I've spoken about sort of field, like from the ether into a plasma into a solid material sort of thing. Would that be more...
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm suggesting is basically all life wants to do this anyway. So my argument is the planet is an alive organism. We are sub-organisms of planet Earth. We may have come here as a genetic this might be someone I need to deal with and I might need to drop out. So give me a sec.
No worries, brother. Thank you. And we are blessed for every moment with Bob. Like, this is epic.
How in the world did you get Bob on here, Bernie?
At
this hour of the day, too.
I've been back and forth with Bob for a while, talking, trying to schedule it. And we just lucked out that I sent him a link this morning. And in it, I boastfully stated that the first segment was specifically dedicated to his most recent videos and work, and it worked out that it was morning there in the UK and he was able to join us, because you and myself tend to be the nighthawks staying up. And
yeah, I'm so stoked myself some alone work time at the lab at night, so that's where I get my best work done, is when everyone else is asleep.
Right, exactly. That's same for me my entire life. When all of these were built, was definitely in the middle of the night by myself while everyone's asleep and can wind away in our own peaceful little moments, right? And if you don't mind sharing again that giant, massive, awesome one that you've made there.
The rod that's in its halfway stage, the one that's not finished, this guy?
Exactly. Yeah. It's always a work.
It is. It's a bunch of friggin' work, and these things are notoriously difficult to work with, especially when you try to you know, spool them up, because they're going to want to take their own little pass when you get these things into a Tor loop. And of course, the way that I wound this, the gauge of wire that I used is too thin. So my field geometry for the gauge of this wire gives me too many loops per larger loop. And it means that I would have to have a ridiculously long length of continuously linked segments of this stuff in order to make that work. And so I need to use a larger gauge wire in order to.
And that's kind of the same issue. And what I'm one, the next step in the process is getting the next ratio of size of copper to iron wires. Because like this one right here is iron, but it's far, far too thin. And I need to get a bit thinner copper wires than how thick this stuff is that I'm regularly working with to be able to make that optimal design there.
What I'd really like to find out is if I can use fence wire, steel fence wire, which is magnetic and not particularly lossy at, you know, 10 to about 150 hertz. It works very well as a transformer core. And even though I prefer a non-conductive ferrite for most applications, in this case, because it's a low frequency, I can insulate that fence wire by spraying it, you know, just stretching it out, spraying it with, like, say, black spray paint or enamel or whatever. And I don't really need to, but it's just another added measure when I wind the magnet wire around it so that I don't end up accidentally scratching the surface. But I'm wondering, because you're already talking about a regular Tor where you have that iron wire, which is conductive, not a great conductor, but it is conductive, and you have a persistent field produced by something which I believe lives in the center of that coil and is not actually part of or attached to the coil, can we just tap the energy right out of the steel cord wire? Or find out that way? If we try to short it out, for example, or if we put a measurement probe directly on it, will it destroy the coherent field that's already self-oscillating in that space? That's what I'm really interested to find out.
Well, in the case of Cosmic Dave, he's shown, or it would appear, that the field self rebuilds. He's got a four-level Tor, and it's an electric field. Of course, it would be with a four-level Tor. So if the electric field is there and it rebuilds, then you might be able to get a pulse out of the one or more levels of core that you might have in there. But then will it then re-exist? I would like to go back to answering your previous question, which was, are we able to harvest energy and so forth? And are we building what you call proto-matter, which is another way of putting it, prima materia? And I use the two interchangeably. Essentially, with I've mentioned this about four or five times, maybe 10 times in my lectures. Shishkin was referring to his cavitator, which is an aluminium with two discs that have grooves in them that intersperse. It produces a lot of cavitation. And this is what he gets his strange radiation flux from. He was actually trying to mix oil and water for commercial purposes. And then he found that he felt really ill around this device that was producing this emulsion of oil and water. And so because he's an expert in radiation, he thought he'd put some x-rays on there, and he found these birdies. And that was what started his journey in strange radiation observations and research. And the point being is that he found that if he ran this in his lab for a period of time, after a while, the x-rays would show no strange radiation birdies. And he would only be able to recreate them again if he physically moved it to a separate part of his lab. And so what this indicates to me is that there is these structures that are forming in the cavitation, resonant structures, which are able to cohere out to a boundary. And what you're seeing with Henk Uren's research with the bagel coil is it seems to non-linearly fall off. And then there's no field beyond that. It's not linear, it's non-linear. And this is exactly what you see in the way that the ball lightning cuts material. It cuts material and then it doesn't cut it at all. It's non-thermal. And when you see the strange radiation tracks interact in the Vega experiments, there's no interaction, and then there's 100% interaction. So there is an event horizon through which you can imagine these microleptons, as the Russians prefer to call them or refer to them, leptons being uncharged and uncharged would be the relic neutrinos. They are able to be influenced. They don't get influenced, and then within the field expanse of the structure that's able to cohere into coherent solitons of relic neutrinos, they are 100% cohered. Now, we already know from Xu En Zhu's work that in a three-body alignment, there is some reflection and refraction of these relic neutrino flux. He didn't know that it was that, but this is the observation he had, that meant there was a lower density because of the gravitational lensing, a higher density on the outside and lower density on the inside. So we know matter can partially reflect these things, and also from Parkhomov's work. So given that fact pattern together, we know that if Shishkin is in a building, if he's opened the doors and he's opened the windows, some amount of relic neutrino flux has gone in there. Some can still pass through the matter because the matter doesn't necessarily absorb all of it. But there is a point at which his device is cohering all of the relic neutrino flux that's already within the event horizon of the thing that's doing the coherence. So he has to physically move to another part of the same lab, which has got closed windows and everything, to be able to continue to cohere. So experiments won't work like continuously if you're in an enclosed environment. You just basically have to put it outside. And so people will, and you can already see the effect of just the metal sheet in Henk Uren's work, right? And so you will probably need to run these generators out in the open, because what they're doing is you're stealing the relic neutrino flux that the Earth would otherwise consume.
It's ironic you say that, because just earlier today I was having a conversation with a good friend, system I'll be verifying fairly soon, and he's got an energy system, or an energy converter system, if you want to call it that. And we were just discussing whether or not it actually needed to be in an open environment, or if it would still work fully enclosed. And we're going to find that out soon enough. So I'll be testing it, starting out in an open environment, checking the coefficient of performance and verifying it all on log meters and data. So we'll find out live. We'll probably do a live broadcast. Well, I guess it's up to him. I'm not the one that invented it, but I will be verifying it properly. And we're going to find out if it can operate in an enclosed container, or if it really does need that open environment. Because your story, what you're telling me right now, is very similar to many of the things I've heard, where it seems almost as if it leaves a ghost image or something in the environment that's almost geostatically locked. I wonder if it's connected to the matter in that region, because if it is, you know, it would make sense that it's connected to the ground. It's going to be really hard to get rid of that. But if it's connected to, say, the shelf or the walls or the, you know, fixtures of the room,
you've got to think that everything, we know that this, whatever is being influenced by these structures is able to move matter along with it, because you see that on the damage patterns on the inside of the lion quartz reactor, okay? The thing itself is not rotating, but it's moving things around it. Now, if you can imagine the neutrino sphere, the relic neutrino sphere of the sun, right? That will be moving with the sun, and probably that's what is moving us around the sun, that, you know, our orbit is relating to that. So all of those things are moving with it. You understand?
Yeah, that really does. That would actually make a lot of sense. Well, you have various bands like that. If this thing basically has a field that itself has a very sharply defined information horizon, and these things can stack up upon each other, it would make sense why we end up with some of the strange phenomena on either a very small scale and large scale.
There is a diffusion, because we know there's a diffusion, because you see this sidewise movement in the brass plate of Xu En Zhu's experiments. And we see in 1954 the changing from oscillation in the Foucault pendulum of Maurice Elias. And so we know 100% that there is the capability of diffusion. So if you open a window, some will diffuse into your environment, and your experiment might start producing these birdies again. If they're producing the birdies, you can do the transmutation. The plant will grow better, right? You know, and certain materials may be better at, you know, for instance, it might be better to grow vegetables in a polytunnel than in a glass house. You know what I mean? Because the
sounds like we're going to find out soon enough, because this stuff is actually out in the open now, and it's going to be tested very, very soon. So I'll be testing plants inside this thing if and only when I can get that field to self-resonate and self-persist.
Sorry.
just a picture of self-coherence of some of this monoatomic stuff rotating all on its own with zero current within it, zero pumps, anything of the sort, and it always will do these rotations and levels and spirals of self-coherence within it.
There is a coil underneath that, right? Underneath the layer?
No, there was a coil just on the far, far corner, and it wasn't even hooked up to electricity or anything.
That spiral that we're looking at, there's nothing actually in the jar underneath that?
Just water, yeah. So you can see the long coil on the top left, but that's just water all on its own. And always when I dump in fresh water into some of these monatomic or plasmoid solutions situations or diatomic, some of this is oxidized. It's a little bit blue in that one. But it will always come up layer and then create the exclusion zones and then self-cohere in these spirals as it goes through and then goes through the different exclusion zones before finally resting. And some of the jars will actually stay like that.
You have to do a stop motion capture of that process occurring. And to remove all doubt, you want to have in that stop motion a pre-video of you removing the coils. Because all the time you've got the coils in there, people will say that's... So you need to remove that. I would expect that there will be...
I've got lots of videos of it just in jars with zero coils or anything of it. Just strictly in a jar with no electricity, no coils, nothing. Just the material.
And it's doing that? It's doing that spiraling?
Spiraling like that like crazy.
I agree with Bob, man. Set up something to take a picture.
I will,
100%. Say 1 minute or 10 minutes.
Some old shitty smartphone that allows you to take a picture every once in a blue moon. Strap it to a USB and get it to take a 50-day sequence of it, in a controlled light box.
Yeah.
And show that it, you can disrupt it. Start by disrupting it so that it, it's just horizontal lines of whatever, or just looks like one homogeneous blob, and then try and catch it. That's real science there. And then you repeat it and then see if it works faster outside. Take it outside and see if you get the formation working faster.
That's actually a very good experiment, real world experiment that I can do to test exactly your thesis of what you're talking about. I love it. I will get
and
on.
So if these are monoatomics, and it doesn't necessarily have to be all monoatomics, but it's statistically there's going to be some in there, they could be doing the self-organization, and you're really delivering some useful science there.
I appreciate that. Thank you, Bob.
That's an excellent idea, and I really hope that you do follow that up, because I would love to see 100% that system self-organize in that way. I have never
actually
seen
had something like that, no, along those lines on my old cell phones before, like in my old lab, and then I lost my phone, and I was so mad. It broke my heart forever, because I had all of it. It's pieces of it along the stages, but I don't
publish
have it all.
And be damned. Or publish and don't publish and be damned. At least, through the process, my view is if you didn't show it, you didn't do it, right? You're just making it up using what you know now, right? The thing is that if you publish something like, if you knew that, what you just showed there, and you published that so that it was available for people to think about, then that goes into the back of their consciousness. And if they see similar things going on, they can then cross relate the information. Just as soon as you've got something, get it out there. Get it out there so it can flourish. And then you don't have to worry about it being lost.
That's what we are now doing together in this moment in time. And I was just pulling up one more to show that I have saved of it. And I promise to keep doing so going forward and setting it up in controlled ways that we can then actually document the evidence of it and use it.
The universe will give you back far more than you give to it.
Always, always. The feedback, you want the positive feedback loop, spiral up, not down.
I hope he does have a video of this. I'm really looking forward to seeing that process happen. If there's nothing underneath that, that's pretty darn interesting. And the question is, where is the fuel being held? Because surely the liquid itself, it's probably not the explanation.
No, it's the actual, if there's monatomics in there, they will be creating a spin field around them, and they will cluster just as you see the damage patterns on the Lion reactor. And like, you can force this by getting matter to spin. So Shishkin and his team, they were able to produce strange radiation birdies by getting almost any matter and spinning it at 5,000 RPM in a cone. And so you have literally electrons and matter and whatever is the rest of matter spinning, and it focuses it down on the cone. I would, their cone was more a 60 degrees, kind of like 120 degrees, like one of that. But I would actually suggest
I have to watch that episode, Bob. I'm guessing you fully covered.
No, I haven't talked about that. No. What? In the next couple of months, I've got permission from Shishkin to translate all his work, and you're going to see it's really spooky. It's going to be really spooky. You'll realize and understand.
We love woo woo.
What?
We love the spooky woo woo.
It's so far ahead. It's so far ahead. You're in a position where you have. It's not about having an open mind so much so that your brain falls out. It's that you haven't got closed minds so that you will automatically dismiss factual things that you can replicate yourself. There is a whole body of
exactly. And then stealing it and then producing it, having it, and being like, hey, look, we verified it. Anyone can do it. And all of us are starting to do it. And it's a wonderful thing. So this specific one was made off of 24 gold bar anode and a 100% silver cathode monatomics. And then I've rinsed it. I made it with 5 volts of AC electricity. I find the best results is actually off of an even smaller amount of like just a AA or two AAs, so 1.5, 3 volts DC. But I rinsed the salt out of this, and it was only salt water and the two metals that produced this. And now after 7 washes, rinses out of the salt and just the pure monatomic, I have started experimenting consuming some of it. Don't do it before you want to sleep, because it will actually keep you awake. And I've started like being able to, like, my cognitive memory and stuff has been increasing ever since. And I've been drinking the waters for about 7 years myself, and continue to do so as well, as it's very healthy. And it's actually tasting sweet now. It's literal sweet water. It's quite pleasant to drink.
Well, I would imagine that I imagine that the Ormos is able to cohere very effectively the Rayleigh neutrino condensate and build these clusters. And the actual cluster itself when it's not firing at high energy and blowing up and throwing high amounts of ions out, and it's not too large, then it's a much lower biological risk, but then life uses it. And my father was a farmer, and he always said, you know, if you can ever use rainwater, use it. Do not use tap water, and especially rainwater from a storm. But of course, you've already seen those, I think it's, is it Kelvin experiments, where you have water dropping and you have a charge separation between them. Okay, and you can actually produce a voltage. So you already know that a water drop is going to be charged. And what are we talking about? Charge clusters. It's already in the rainwater. It's already there. So rainwater is automatically. I even think it's better when you're watering your plants with tap water to actually do it through a sprayer. Because it goes up, gets charged, and drops down. It's actually better than just even drip feeding.
I love that you just put science to something I've done instinctually with my own plants and misting them forever throughout the years, especially when I was growing my medical. Even misting
through something that will cause...
Yeah, because you're spritzing it up and... It's the same sort of thing with HHO, how it's turning to HHO mist and HHO fuel, as opposed to it just being pure hydrogen, is that mist charge cluster aspect you're talking about, right?
What does a mist have in it?
I don't even know. Just the funnel, the shape?
Well, it's got a restriction valve. It's got compression, and it's going to cavitate at the very end as you spray it. If you
cavitate a hole, it will produce tori. It will produce condensing of the energy, and it will produce friction as it goes through. This is exactly what you saw with the HHO plasma going through a carbon tube when the coherent matter wave was formed by Slobodan Stankovic using HHO. This is exactly what Leclerc was doing when he was having a perforated 1 mil or 2 mil thick aluminium sheet, and it was perforated with big holes and little holes. And what he did was he had high pressure on this end and a low pressure down that end, and it produces toroidal cavitation, focusing the energy.
And you were saying that one though had high radiation though, right? That it's kind of, it was dangerous to be around, and that's one of the main reasons why I don't.
And that's
hook
the
up
beauty of Roy Schlimazer's equipment, is he's just vibrating it like a fish fin. In fact, he likes fish. And so he's vibrating. We know it produces cavitation. We know it produces ultrasonics, but it's not taking it to the max. We need to use this technology gently. There's a point at which it becomes damaging to health.
Quick question, Bob. Is that essentially what would have made Victor Schauberger's technology work as well, as cavitation?
Well, he had a lot of technology. So if you're floating logs down a flume, you've got friction on the side and it pushes that stuff and you get denser material in the middle. And, you know, if you're putting things through a vortex, the denser nucleons will go to the middle, so you get a higher concentration of deuterium in the center. So there's all kinds of different things that where flow will do this. But if you really do intense vortexes that you see in the ultra experiments, you're going to get a bubble. On a bubble, you're going to have charge separation, but also you're going to have a dielectric boundary, and that will produce easy water on the outside of this spinning torus structure, which is going like this and like that. So you're literally creating exactly what you need like that.
Yeah, that's so straightforward and awesome. I love the simplicity.
It's so simple to understand when you have a clue. And for me, this is a bit of a joke now, because I feel like I'm cheating the whole time. All of these mysteries, they're just...
The Wizard of Wizards, Bob.
As Victor Schomburg said himself, comprehend and copy nature.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's all there. If you are trying to technologically tell nature what to do, then you are going to be fighting.
You're already fighting the force and having resistance instantly, as opposed to just operating in harmony and then able to pull the energy out.
You have to work with what nature's ontological will is. You have to do that. You have to work in the way that it wants to work. And that's not just about resonance. That's the whole kit and caboodle. You have to work with it to get the most from it. It's like if you want to get the most from your community of people, you know, your family, you have to work with them. If you're going to say things that are going to cause resistance, you're not going to get very far. You know, and everyone, me included, has experienced this kickback you get when you're not working within the system, as it were. The problem is when the system is people who are already trying to fight nature, and they don't agree that you should be doing it with nature. They agree that you should be doing it as their patent says, and if they're not doing it as their patent says, then it doesn't exist. So
it's far more profitable to go against nature, because that way you have a limited resource that only you can provide.
Well, you can argue that, but if you are going with nature and you get things done a lot more energy efficiently, or you synthesize things that have high value, which, you know, people who are saying, well, you can't possibly have made that with alchemy. You can't possibly. So I'm going to pay the full price for it. And you go, ha ha, sucker you.
Well, the reason why I say it's more profitable is because the truth is, in a future where scarcity is no longer a thing, because we can literally fabricate matter and transmute everything that we need, there really is no point to having to worry about any of these things. So who cares how profitable it is when we're not trading in profits, but instead in resources and creativity and time and effort, in real valuable human commodities that actually equal something tangible for our biological existence. Because I'll tell you what, none of us are born with a wallet. Than anyone that ever has been. So,
but you know. In many countries, you're born with debt.
Yes, yes, you are, including mine.
You're born with an empty wallet.
Well, technically, you're not born with that. But once you receive your false identification and social security number with your name in all caps, system. I mean, then your character that you've been labeled is born with that debt, but technically, at the moment of the womb, you're not born with any of that. They have to give you a social security number and assign you a value and a false name first. So technically, yeah, you're still born free.
And what are we showing there, Bert? Okay.
Okay. Man, it's just awesome to have you on and finally get a chance to talk about these coils, because I have so many experiments I'm looking forward to trying and finding out where the field is stored, how sensitive it is, and how much we can screw with it. I mean, heck, I kind of just want to take a small magnet and throw it in there and see if it'll decohere the whole thing or if I can drag it along. You know, there's just so many experiments that I want to explore with this thing. And well, if he's getting a fourth order electric...
Cosmic Dave has shown that he can build a field and then move the coil. The field persists for, in his case, an hour or so, indeterminate. And he can move the coil, and actually some of the field will move with the coil and some of it will be left free in space.
Have you seen Adam's video or heard his description? Do you know Adam yet?
No, sorry.
Okay, so Adam is a fellow in our research group, and he built something some over 20 years ago he called the Curious Device. It was sort of a Wimshurst machine, and it was assembled instead of using...
You would do
the same exact thing with his device. One field stayed in the room exactly where it was sitting, the other one came with the disc. What he did is he took apart the two discs. He didn't take the whole machine, he just took one of the two discs with him. One of the fields stayed with the machine in the room, the other one stayed with the disc. So he tells a really fascinating story that I find absolutely intriguing. And in the story, he's got this little home wireless phone. They don't have a particularly good range. That's well known. And lots of things can block the field. But I think it was a 900 megahertz. Anyways, he's walking down the block, and he gets quite a ways away, way far outside of the range, at least five or six times. And he's carrying one of these discs with him, just, you know, walking along. And he didn't realize he had the phone in his pocket, so he gets a call.
I'm with you. It teleported the communication.
Exactly. And yeah, to me, when I heard about that, I'm like, what we have here is something incredible if we can understand it. And this whole technology
I genuinely believe the very best way to understand it is with proper controlled known coils of a known size with a known folding interaction with seed germination. Because the first biological transmutation that is on record is 1698 seed germination.
I'm about to go water half of my newly planted garden, one side of each of the rows with this monoatomic water. The other half will just get the hose and they will both get rain.
Fantastic.
I would love your thoughts on what I'm showing here, these reddish clusters. I believe it is, and what I read in Isaac Newton's alchemy writings, as well as others, they claim it's the mercury state. And this right here is a piece of zinc that has this red stuff coming off of. But I've been able to turn copper, iron, zinc, aluminum, silver, and several other metals also into this red stuff. And I'm wondering, is it actually a mercury compound that this is, and that the alchemists themselves claim that this is mercury? How would I be able to test that, and would it best bet be to send it to you to get a good result?
You can send a sample, but you can't be sure that if alchemy is involved
it's not whether the alchemy, it's more just if I'm able to get it tested and the initial results point to it having mercury, then it would be that mercury appeared out of nowhere and was a real transmutation in this electrolysis process that just had.
So obviously water. If you send it when I get a chance to look at it under the SEM, I can give you an indication.
There's absolutely no rush, but it's like, should we put it in the process? And it would be
You should be putting it in the process, because I can't say when I'm going to get access to it all. But when I do, it can be on the roster. Something like that should be fairly quick.
Perfect. That is good enough for me. And it's like when the universe says the time is right, it will randomly appear to you and you'll have that extra sample and it'll be the perfect thing. I know, just like today works out. It's how it always does.
A friend of mine is working on a coil system that he has seen multiple times the production of strange materials dropping out of that system, little black beads on the bench, and has also seen the leads of other common electronic components completely eroded away. And they're usually pretty darn tough. They either have a nickel or a tin plating commonly, and they're not particularly subject even to a slightly acidic vapor environment. So whatever he's producing around these coils, and even if it's ozone, obviously that's not going to eat through these metals in the way that it has. So what he's set out to do now is take some plates. I've asked him to polish them highly and clean them off with rubbing alcohol. So he's starting with a nice, clean sample that's flat of various materials. I guess he's got iron, he's got copper, he's got aluminum, I think he's got zinc. We talked about getting nickel, a variety of other various materials that he can send to you in small sizes. Now, what size sheet would you prefer if you were to, say, throw all these things in the SEM and pump it down just to make the job easier? What size metal samples that have been...
So I would, to make my life easier, this particular SEM is a 10 by 10 centimeter stage, and it can take things at 6 centimeters high. But obviously, in terms of shipping something, you want it as small as possible and in the innocuous as possible. Always put samples in plastic. What you could do is pre-mount the individual samples on a larger, thin sheet of metal, say aluminium, because the stage has already got an aluminium base. And then I can put it in there and look at 10 samples at a time without too much effort.
Well, if that's the case, it's no problem to pre-mount, but I do not want to accidentally suggest that he use an adhesive that's going to outgas inside the SEM and cause you problems.
So you can buy standard carbon tape mounts, and you could get an aluminium plate and put the round carbon tape mounts on there, which are sticky on both sides. You can't see hydrogen and carbon. You're not going to see through the metal sample to see the carbon underneath. And so you then stick them in an array, and you then package that in plastic and then send that as a thing. And I just drop it in there and I go boom, 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 boom.
I'll pass that along to him.
Yeah, and even if he's got a thin aluminium sheet, he could then actually mark S1, S2, S3, S4. And when you see it on the SEM, you'll see the samples and you'll see which one we're looking at. And it's all self-consistent. One video, you're done.
Yeah, that'll be no problem at all. You won't have any problem with that. Yeah. This sounds pretty darn good. I'm very interested to find out if something as simple as a coil device operated at the right kinds of frequencies and potentials that it's clearly already producing these kinds of effects. It's eroding surfaces that should be pretty resilient and robust. It's causing problems with other metals, and it's producing apparently strange materials that he's not sure exactly what they are.
I've talked about this in relation to the accelerated decay of material and long-term decay of Hutchison effect materials. And what it is that charge clusters act like mega electrons, right? And they absolutely love oxygen. So if you've got something like aluminium and it likes to be oxidized quickly, as everyone knows, you score your aluminium pan and immediately it starts to oxidize. Imagine that taken to the max, where paramagnetic oxygen in the air, and it is the most paramagnetic gas, you have to go up to lanthanides to have more paramagnetic materials. And so it's a unique gas. And it interacts with charge clusters like nothing else. And so if you have metals in which we know charge clusters, exotic vacuum objects, microball lightning, whatever, like to live, and you've synthesized them in there by either resonant nodes of phonon vibrational modes or by impinging resonant nodes of plasmons on the surface, or however you've synthesized it, then they will be sitting there in the metal, and they will be really, 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 really wanting to get the oxygen jiggy with whatever the metal is. And so you will have accelerated corrosion.
Man, that'd be awesome if his coils are producing exotic vacuum objects that end up getting embedded into the metals. Because otherwise, like, some of these components were new, never used, and they still ended up doing the same thing. They weren't connected to any kind of electrical power sources, and so how they got damaged in that way with nothing but apparently fields being produced by these systems would demonstrate that this doesn't need a vacuum environment, or it doesn't need a high temperature, or it doesn't need any kind of special gases or controls. It could basically be done in an open atmosphere in a controlled way, or in a semi-controlled way, at least is what it suggests, using nothing but field geometries and electromagnetic pulses. And that would really open a whole new doorway to how we can deal with using the brand new technology.
It may very well be the case that you can, if you look at the experiments of Cosmic Dave, he's only exposing the coil for a very short period of time, and then he builds a field that's there for a long period of time. And it may be that you only need to run a few cycles through the structure. And Ken Scholder says these are electronic structures built at electronic speeds, right? So you may only need to turn, let's say you've got 50 hertz, you might only need to run it through one cycle. But the problem is you don't want to pulse it on and pulse it off, because that gives you all kinds of other harmonics that will be stuck in there. So you kind of want to turn the power on from zero, take it up to the target frequency, and then ramp it down to zero, okay? And then take it off. Therefore, you will get a pure frequency in the self-organized structure. And so you might need to turn it on and ramp it up and down for a number of cycles of the target frequency you're trying to keep in that particular phantom.
Well, and then if that's the case, we can just basically hook it to an audio amplifier, right? We could just hook it straight up to an audio amp and give it a perfect sine if we wanted to, or give it whatever shape we wanted to give it. And
you give it the target frequency. You give it the target frequency, but you have a ramp from zero up and a ramp from zero from peak down to zero. And already various researchers are finding that it doesn't almost matter how much power you give it beyond a certain point. You don't get the field any stronger. What you're effectively setting up is the pointing vectors that are closed, and then they have a maximum capability based on the overall structure of the thing that's creating them. Yeah. So yeah, you might, people might say, oh, you need to put 10,000 volts in there. And you go, no, you might only need 1 volt. And if ancient people were able to.
10,000 will create a harmful effect as opposed to just the 1 volt, which will be perfect.
This is subtle resonant energies. You need to be gentle with this. Nature isn't typically producing thousands of volts. Maybe an electric
cold fusion, right? It's nature's harmonic little energy. Yeah. It's not that hot forcing, bursting everything required. It's just that harmonic.
It might be that the typical lemon voltage that you get from copper and zinc might be all you need. It might be all you need to set up these fields. And then you know that the ancient peoples could have done this. They had copper. They could have wound copper.
I believe it actually is, Bob. And I'm going to show you this one right here. All it is copper, three copper solenoid wires together that I had nano-coated. So essentially like a couple of these guys. And then in salt water in a sealed jar. And then I connected the tops to each other and the bottoms to each other in insulated copper wire as well. And it started producing hydrogen electrolysis off of the bottom of it, sealed, doing this for 6 months. And you'll see on the bottom all of the pure white, what looks to be just monoatomic copper that formed within it and collected. And I've never put any current into it, never opened it. And it's been sitting like this now for about 2 years.
Right.
Well, I'd say with that, we have some experiments to run, some very significant experiments involving a whole lot of different coil geometries. I've dubbed this one the year of the coils in an earlier chat, and that because it really does seem to be the year of the coils across the board, not just for me, not just for you, but the amount of people that I've met this year has blown my mind. I have met 5 different people with systems that can produce very phenomenal artifacts and effects, in some cases up to and including, you know, floating, levitation, whatever you want to call it. We're still trying to work out what the heck it is, because it does not act like a gravitational force in the conventional sense. And I've got my theories too, and other theories have been presented to me, as well as some people who have taught me what they're pretty confident about it being, but not everybody agrees. So we're still working that out. Either way, every single one of these 5 coils all does the same 2 things. One, it generates a torsion tensor field, and two, it operates by a geometry.
Well, torsion fields, which are probably another name for what we're generating anyway with these fields, if they're wrong, or they can be very bad for biology. So this is why I implore people to not be close to these things, not to to push it too hard, and to work with biology that is not you. So I think the most important tests that can be conducted are the ones with seed germination, because if you take a mung bean, they will go from mung bean to a really nice shoot in about 3 days. We grow them here for Asian cooking in you know, Tetra Pak cartons. So you can easily grow these things. They're very cheap, and so you can have an experiment every 3 days.
And if that's the case, there's a tremendously valuable market for people wanting to get into growing stuff that they can easily set up in their homes using these small systems. Local grocery stores will oftentimes buy very small seedlings, you know, small plants, you know, in their tiniest stage as they're growing up, because they have a very, very high nutrient packing. So these microgreens, as they call them, are high value. And if people want to start getting into these things, here's a great reason why you should start experimenting with these kinds of coils and systems, because it could easily pay your bills, quite frankly, if you really want to get into it.
Typically, they like temperatures that are good for biology, which I think is a resonant phonon temperature. So body temperature is already exactly what you need. Because body temperature is what we do, and we are a biological machine. You don't need to guess this. So 36, 37 degrees C, these kind of temperatures are what you should be targeting for. You know, this is if you go to the most biodiverse rich places on Earth, they are in the tropics, where the temperature is around human body temperature, right? For a good proportion of the year, right? So we don't need to guess this. The nature has already told us what we need. And so you get for mung beans, you will want to be at that temperature, and you will want to have if we can get away with, because these things grow in the dark, you don't even need to provide them any grow lamps, right? And so mung beans like to be in the dark. In fact, you want them in the dark because you don't want any chlorophyll produced, because it changes the flavor. You want them to just be the seed germination.
I did not know that. That's fascinating.
Yeah. So that's why I use a carton, like a Tetra Pak carton for like 1 liter of milk or whatever. Just wash it out, and you put one layer of mung beans down there, and 3 days later you have extremely nutritious food that you can have in a salad or fry with a stir fry or whatever. But if you could get them to germinate in 2 days and grow to full length and stronger and thicker than 3 days, you've literally gained 33% more production. Right. And if you can do that for the cost of a reusable coil that you just pulse for a few seconds every 1 or 2 hours, I mean, the energy cost is basically negligible.
And exactly. I mean, we could solve food shortages quite literally with this kind of tech.
Yeah. And not only just food shortages where you are giving them meaningless calories like starch from whatever, you're giving them the highest level of nutrients, that this early life, that, you know, this where everything is like actually all freshly, if they're synthesizing new elements from using this technology to make all of the elements that are necessary for a healthy future, then they are monatomics that they're making. The plant life is doing it. Because they're new, freshly synthesized atoms. So I don't know, but basically, for me, mung bean, and then we need to know, because it's as valuable to know what makes them work, not grow at all, as it is what makes them grow. Because the what makes them not grow at all could allow people to have, say, let's say you've got a throat cancer, you could have a coil manifold that gets put around the neck, and it's pulsed a few seconds every hour, right? And it prevents the cancer from growing. But that is the negative effect.
And then around your femur, you have the positive effect to increase your body's production of white blood cells. And it's a twofer.
That's what you meant by the healing tech. Now I understand what you were describing. That makes a lot more sense as an example.
So it's as valuable to know what makes mung bean shoots stunted as it is to know which coil configuration makes them grow fast. Because then you have healing tech. One is to promote the growth of your white blood cells that kill the cancers, right? And the other one is to prevent the cancer from progressing. Done. It's done. Cancers, forget it. It's done.
I am so glad that you said that. I'm so glad that you gave an example, because that is tremendous. And it relates, once again, right back into a conversation we were having earlier today, which I just find fascinating. The synchronicities on these things are starting to get, well, pretty stark, I would say. Pretty stark
indeed. It starts to get a bit weird, doesn't it?
It's been weird since the beginning of the year. The first of this year was a totally new reality to walk right
into. I've always been weird. I love the woo. Synchronicities are what makes the universe go round.
I'm pretty sure there's a lot more truth in that than he even realizes.
Okay, so I'm going to have to duck out now because I've got...
No worries, Bob. Thank you so much for gracing us. It was a pleasure to have you on, and we will keep in touch. And
Is this going to be shared somewhere, the recording?
Yeah, it's being live on my YouTube right now. Okay. And I'll send you the link to it as soon as we're done here.
Awesome. Perfect. Catch you guys later. Fight
much love, Bob. Thank you so much.
Let's change the course of humanity by just doing.
100%.
That's the only way that we can.
Continue being the change you want to see in this world. Oh, before you leave, though, my girlfriend Amber has been watching and insisting that if you could please discuss ferrofluids a little bit more and how you're involving them in your setup, because she absolutely loves and is fascinated by them, as am I, and I need to get some.
So I'm just thinking that basically Cosmic Dave has used polymer tubes to do his third and fourth level tubing to form his four level tours as the cores. So these things, if you get one that's able to be thermoset, you could do what they do with pipe welding. You have a hot plate that heats up both sides, and then you fuse them together. Then you drill a little hole in the top so the air can come out, and then you have a syringe and you just pump ferrofluid into the tube, which is now a closed torus. And then you hot seal the tube, so you end up with the ferrofluid in there. So you have some with some core that's got some level of magnetic permeability, but the ferrofluid itself is able to organize not just in one array, it's able to perfectly arrange itself. So I think, you know, we will be able to study whether having something with a different levels of Tor has an acceleration effect for the process. But I think early thing is just the most important test. And it's kind of like winner takes all. Like the first person to demonstrate repeatedly, I can make this coil, I can make it every day of the week. If it's in this configuration and I give it these fields, then it promotes growth. If I give it these fields, it prevents growth or stunts growth. And I think those two things will have total, unimaginably profound consequences for the course of humanity.
I honestly think we're going to see those things this year be proven.
I couldn't agree more. And what you're proposing is the most reasonable and safest way for us to all implement this technology and start using it ourselves. And it's absolutely awesome that we're all coming together making it happen.
I agree, with a fair bit of warning, a fair bit of warning, but also a whole lot of encouragement. Know what it can do to hurt you, but go do it anyways. Do it safely, though. But do it anyways.
But do it safely.
And the other thing is, listen to what nature is telling you. Body temperature is the temperature you should be doing these tests at. So everyone has a controlled environment. Humidity should be probably quite high, okay? Because the plants do best in humidity, right? And then lastly, 50 hertz in Piantelli's work has been shown to have biological effects.
Okay. The reason the Schwerblis was shown at 30 hertz is because there isn't a fundamental or harmonic that is relating to the 50 hertz that was in the mains in the test environment. So they couldn't claim it was induction. So that's why they used 30 hertz. So you could use 50 hertz, which already has a history of a biological effects positive to cancer in decades of his treatment of people in Italy. But also, you could try the Schumann resonance because that is what our planet runs on. Okay.
And so,
you know, you could use that frequency. And so there's a whole set of parameters. So the first real win is which frequencies are promoting or stunting growth. And then that is one parameter space or configuration of coil that can affects everything. And then in terms of biology, you then need to focus on what biology resonates with. The phonon resonance of the 37 or 36 degrees temperature, and that's the terahertz phonon resonance of atoms in the environment. And then the other one is the photon resonance or the electromagnetic resonance. So one is a physical resonance in the matter, and the other one's the field resonance. And we do not need to fight nature. I'll say it again, and I've said it before, and I said it in my Sochi presentation publicly the first time, but in 2015, in January, when we were on Project Fedora with Francesco Pientelli, Professor Francesco Pientelli, who discovered the nickel hydrogen Lenna system in a biology experiment, by the way, he said, "Don't tell nature what it is, let nature show you." Okay. And with that, I'm going to say, see you later.
Thanks, Bob. Much love and respect, sir.
Thank you very much. Much appreciated to have some of those questions answered. I've been wanting to know a few things about that for a while now. And I love the idea of using a magnetic core. So I will catch you on your next live stream. I try to catch them all.
For sure. Everyone, thank you so much for joining in. I think it's a perfect time to end it. And on that note, be the change you want to see. And thank you for joining us on this journey. I know I'm going to be rewatching this episode a few times. And I'm sure so will you, Jeremiah. And much love to you all.